Ghost in the Ashes, The Ghosts, Book 7. Written by Jonathan Moeller. Narrated by Hollis McCarthy. Chapter 1. Knives in the Night. Caina Amalas opened her eyes. Something was wrong. She turned her head, her hair rustling against the pillow. A pale shaft of moonlight leaked through the balcony doors. In the gloom, she saw the table that held her mirror and cosmetics, a wooden stand for Corvallis's weapons and armor, and the wardrobe that contained her disguises. Corvallis lay next to her, eyes closed, chest rising and falling with his breath. It was utterly silent. Yet Caina was certain that she had heard someone scream. She pushed aside the blankets and stood, her bare feet silent against the floor, her hair cool and dry as it brushed her shoulders. Her right hand slid under her pillow and retrieved a dagger, the razor-edged blade glinting in the moonlight. She had a hard time sleeping without a weapon close at hand. Caina crossed to the balcony doors and pushed them open a few inches, looking into the street below. Thick fog choked Mallory's streets, transformed into a pale silver haze by the full moon overhead. Successful merchants occupied this district of the imperial capital, merchants with money enough to purchase townhouses separate from their shops, but not enough to imitate the lifestyles of the high lords. Through the silvery fog, Caina glimpsed the houses across the street, tall and narrow, with small courtyards encircled by iron fences. The smell of brine and rotting fish filled her nostrils, carried by the fog rolling off the harbour. Yet the street was deserted. She shook her head in annoyance, still certain she had heard someone scream. Caina stepped away from the doors and saw Corvallis Aberon standing behind her. He was tall and lean, his arms and chest heavy with muscle, his eyes like cold jade discs. Strange spiraling black tattoos marked his pale torso. Inked by an Ulkari witchfinder, the tattoos gave him a measure of resistance to sorcery, which had saved his life more than once. A dagger gleamed in his right hand. Like Caina, he always slept with weapons at hand. Unlike Caina, he was unable to sleep at all unless he had a weapon nearby. His training had been rather more brutal than hers. "There was a time," said Caina, "when I would have been alarmed to find a naked man with a dagger in my bedroom." Corvallis barked his short, harsh laugh. He ran his free hand over his face, the blonde stubble rasping beneath his calloused palm. "What is amiss?" "I heard someone scream," said Caina. Corvallis looked out the balcony doors and back at her. Caina shrugged. "Perhaps I dreamed it."
"No," said Corvallis. "A dream wouldn't fool you."
"One of the servants?" said Caina. They had a pair of maids, a cook, a seneschal, and a footman who doubled as the night watchman. Had someone attacked the house? Any number of people wanted Caina dead, and Corvallis's father would never forgive his defeat at Catacaron 10 months earlier. "No. If they screamed, it would have awakened both of us." Corvallis shook his head.
8 months we've played this game, and I still cannot get used to the idea of servants."
Caina shrugged. "If it helps, think of them as Anton Koularis's servants, not yours. A man like Anton Koularis has servants." She looked into the fog-choked street. It was still deserted.
"True," said Corvallis. "I'll go speak with them and see if anything is amiss. Let them know you heard someone screaming."
Caina smiled. "They'll think I'm flighty and irrational."
"Ah," said Corvallis. "But you are Anton Koularis's mistress. and a man like Anton Koularis has both servants and a flighty, irrational mistress. He put a quick kiss on her lips. Go to sleep. I'll speak with the servants. If there's anything wrong, I'll come get you. Otherwise, you'll want to be arrested when we speak with Master Basil tomorrow. Caina nodded. He has news about the new Lord Ambassador from Istarinmul, I am sure. She shivered, and not just from the cool air against her bare skin. She remembered the last time she had seen a Lord Ambassador from Istarinmul, the day that Razir Shehan had come to Marsus. But his arrival had been a trap. Razir Shehan had allied with Andromache of New Kaia and smuggled troops into the city. Caina remembered the ambush, women and children screaming as lightning fell from the sky, the shouts of fighting men, Nikolai sobbing for his mother, the cold blue glow in the immortal's eyes. She looked back at the street and saw a gleam of blue light in the mist. Caina went rigid. Caina, said Corvallis. For a dreadful moment, Caina thought she was dreaming, that her nightmares had come to life. A man walked on the street below, moving at a rapid pace. He looked like a caravan guard out for a night of drinking, clad in leather armor and a ragged cloak. Yet there were no taverns nearby, which made it an odd place for a caravan guard to go after dark. But his eyes reminded Caina of her nightmares, specifically the blue glow coming from his eyes. Corvallis, whispered Caina. His eyes. Corvallis frowned. He's an immortal, said Caina.
So, said Corvallis. What is one of the Padishah of Istarinmul's elite soldiers doing in Malare?
They looked at each other, and Caina knew what they had to do next. Caina had taken many names and disguises in her life. Countess Mariana Near-Eyed, a minor noblewoman. Marina, the maid of Theodosia, the leading lady of the Grand Imperial Opera. Marius, a caravan guard. Anna Kalenius, the daughter of the wealthy master merchant Basil Kalenius. Sonia Tornesti, the mistress of the rakish merchant Anton Koularis. But she changed names and identities as easily as she changed clothing, for she was a ghost nightfighter, one of the spies and agents of the Emperor of Nighmar. Caina moved to the wardrobe, catching sight of her reflection in the mirror as she did. In the moonlight, she looked lean and pale, the muscles in her arms and legs visible, the scar below her navel an ugly gash across her belly. The moonlight caught her pale blonde hair and turned it silver. Blonde hair. She was just vain enough to find that an irritation. But dyeing it had made sense. There were many among the nobles and the magi of Malare who would kill a black-haired, blue-eyed woman of the ghosts on sight, and Caina needed to disguise herself. She opened the wardrobe, lifting out the false bottom, and all thoughts of her appearance fled her mind. Caina dressed in black boots, trousers, and a black jacket, lined with steel plates to deflect knife blades. Black gloves covered her hands, and a mask concealed everything except her eyes. Daggers went in her boots, throwing knives up her sleeves, and a belt holding more knives and other useful tools went around her waist. Last came the cloak. The cloak was a marvelous thing, woven of both spider silk and shadow by a method known only to the night keepers of the ghosts. It blurred around her, merging with the shadows. Additionally, the cloak also protected her from mind-affecting sorcery and rendered her undetectable to divinatory spells. It had saved her life more than once. She turned just as Corvallis finished dressing.
He had clothing similar to hers, a shadow cloak over his shoulders, but he wore black chainmail beneath a leather jerkin and carried a sword at his hip. She nodded, and Corvallis headed for the balcony with a slim.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.